y me han encargado
I've also been
que haga las palabras introductorias,
charged with making an introductory presentation. This is an honor for me, not only because this Fearless Cities event is really important on a political level, but also on a personal level, and above all, because I need to make this introductory address to the event at large, but specifically to this opening event formed by people who I truly admire. I would like to take this opportunity for those of you involved in this panel to share my admiration. I really admire you. We will be seeing each other over the coming days. And I feel I just wanted to convey these words. Thank you so much for your work, for your efforts, and for what you do in leading organizations and political processes as important as those we will see in this event, Fearless Cities. The Fearless Cities event, as you know, started in the year 2017. The first edition was organized by Barcelona en Comú, and thereafter it has moved around the world. There have been Fearless Cities events in Brussels, New York, Warsaw, Belgrade, Naples, also in Valparaíso, an event I would particularly like to mention, not only because I was able to attend physically, but mentioning the Valparaíso event and mentioning Chile helps me to highlight one of the many events that are occurring in recent times, in recent hours, and I think this should be mentioned to have a clear snapshot of what is the climate, the environment in which this Fearless Cities event 2021 will unfold. Obviously, the event I'm referring to is the appointment of Elisa Loncón, an indigenous woman, a feminist, Mapuche, as president of the Chilean Constituent Assembly. That is really important for the history of Chile. It is also important in global terms, and I think it's important to note this. For two characteristics we can say are relevant with respect to the meaning of what is this process of building these international events, the Fearless Cities events, because the presence or the appointment of Elisa Loncón in the presidency of the Chilean Assembly is the result of the three political levels, of the three levels. You know, on the one hand, the insurgencies, that is, people calling upon others to action, also the reestablishment of forms of political action that aims to manage things in a different way and to transform the way in which policy is made in institutions, and lastly, the transformation of day-to-day life, which is the effect brought about, or it should be brought about, by the result of these processes of citizen insurgency, as well as the way of doing politics in a different way. I also believe it's important to mention this happy event, the appointment of a woman, an indigenous woman, a feminist, a Mapuche, as president of the Constituency of Chile, because this is the result, or it allows me to think, what are the three time modes in which political processes that can be met in Fearless Cities if they overlap? On the one hand, the first gathering in 2017, the first one organized by Barcelona en Comú, and the organization itself, like many sister organizations the world over, are the direct heirs of the cycle of insurgencies for democratic radicalization that took place between 2011 and 2013. And in turn, it was the result of the economic financial crunch between 2007 and 2008, a cycle of citizenship insurgencies that started in the Maghreb, that went through Greece, Spain, Portugal, many squares around the world, but also included the the juvenile, the youth and student movements in Mexico, Chile, Colombia. And this particular event that took place in 2001 was marked by a different climate at that time, of three great global insurgencies that took place in recent years. I'm referring to the movement for global climate emergency, the movement or the fourth feminist global wave, and the LGBTQ movement, and also the anti-racist and anti-colonialism. Global anti-colonial event, a much more recent one. The fact that this is recent does not mean that these are recent processes. This is the third timeline I wanted to refer to. If we speak about the movement for climate action, the fourth feminist global action, and the LGBTQ global movement, and the anti-racist or anti-colonial movement, we're talking about global insurgencies that are facing the three structures, the three skeletons sustaining the architecture of this third timeline I want to refer to, a long drawn out historical process throughout which a model for the construction of our societies has emerged, represented by the four long decades of neoliberal hegemony. But in a nutshell, this has to do with what we identify very generally as these three structures, these three skeletons, the patriarchy and capitalism. I wanted to refer to this because everything that will be discussed in the Filosofies event, even the more detailed information on local policies, the most simplest things, those that are apparently more simplistic, will need to be measured, bearing in mind this historical complexity I just described, because we are not here, as we've said many times before in events like this, to implement different policies. We are here to try to transform institutions. In our hands, they can be tools for emancipation, but we should not forget that they're also modeled or shaped in historical terms due to the intertwining of these three structures: capitalism, patriarchy, and colonialism. To conclude, I said I would mention several events over the last few days that can help us to shape the climate in which this event will unfold. So allow me to refer to three other events. The first is the Abertas Cáceres judgment in Honduras, or the second trial for the assassination of Berta Cáceres, and the court order will be known very soon in the next few hours. We still call for action for justice due to her assassination. We call for justice, and we still support the harassment, the violence, even the assassination of leaders that defend climate and territories in Latin America and other places in the world. They're not alone. You are not alone. It's very important to mention this event and to know what will happen in the next few hours with the Aberta Cáceres trial, a specific trial, but a symbol, nevertheless, of both violence and the struggles in the fight for the defense of regions. We also need to mention that still today, and I'm sure it will continue over the coming days, the days during which this event will unfold, the deaths in the southern border in Europe and in the Mediterranean Sea, which is the common grave, the most important common grave in history. This is really important to mention. And one needs to recall that the deaths in the European borders and in the Mediterranean are not just deaths, they're political assassinations, political homicide. This needs to be borne in mind in this environment, in this context. We must also mention that a few days ago, a neighbor from the neighborhood of Sants committed suicide when he was about to be evicted. I don't recall, this shows to what extent violence exercised through economy mainly are also political violence. This reminds us as to how much way we need to go when it comes to emancipatory public policies that focus on the protection and of people, especially in the political situations in which we are governed by, let's call them progressive or populist governments. And the last event I would like to refer to is the assassination a few hours ago for Samuel Luis in Coruña, an assassination committed by a group of people
grito de,
fighting or shouting gay.
A mí me parece que hay varias cuestiones.
It seems to me that there are several things that should make us think in relation to these events that I just referred to, in particular, in relation to the assassination of Samuel Luis.
En primer lugar, nos tiene que hacer pensar
first
el
of all,
hecho de que
we need to think that
nos estremece darnos cuenta hasta qué punto teníamos razón.
We need to see to what extent we were right when for many decades we had said that our political struggles are just struggles against violence, death, and in favor of life. The triggering of this articulation, of this coupling that is taking place between a neoliberalism in terminal crisis and the insurgency of new ways of neo-fascism or totalitarianism, places death, assassination, and crime at the heart of these policies. So this is an issue that should be mentioned. To what extent we are perplexed
and
stricken. We had been right when for so many decades we had said that our policies are policies that defend life. And another aspect I would like to mention to conclude as a reflection in relation to these events I just referred to, in particular the last assassination, is that the institutional leap, the strengthening of powers and counterpowers from citizens in the local regions, etc., must be profoundly related to a political struggle around the modeling or the construction of subjectivities. It is of the utmost importance to lead this fight against neoliberalism. It is really important to have social struggle against new forms of fascism. But also important, or much more important than this, this will not be successful unless we do our very best to lead non-fascist lives. In the 60s, in 1968, it was said, it is important to develop anti-fascist movements, but it's fundamental to build and live non-fascist lives. It seems to me that the idea of not living a fascist life, of living a non-fascist life, is something that is very much related to other mottos or slogans. When feminism calls for the reconstruction of our roles, codified genre, it's like when the anti-colonial movement asks us not to be just be against racism, but to live anti-racist lives. There is something in these events that is very regular, very usual, which is the implementation of public policies, emancipatory policies, the construction of emancipatory political processes, the empowerment of citizens, or the regional powers. But we should not lose sight of the fact that these public policies and the construction of our political processes should always pay very special attention to the fact that in our organizations, also in our political processes, we need to live our lives in a non-fascist way. And with this reflection, I put an end to my introduction, and I would like to say once again, it is an honor to address you in this opening session, which is politically really important, but on a personal level also really important, not just for me, but for other colleagues of Barcelona and Comú. We have an emotional bond. We would like to welcome you all to this event in a semi-presential way or remotely. I hope in future we're able to recover sooner than later face-to-face meetings, just to be able to live these non-fascist lives. This is really important. And let's carry on fighting in favor of the construction of a world with many worlds in it. And in this world of worlds, we can build, we can live our lives, the lives that we are defending, lives that are worthwhile living. Precisely because they are dignified lives.